Hello and welcome to this video. Today I'll be talking about the differences between a flat and a segmented network and why this is actually important when it comes to security. Flat and segmented networks. So if we have a small company, we might have a network that looks like this, and then you have one subnet, you have some clients connected to this, and you have your servers connected to this, and perhaps you even have a database connected to this. So, since this is single subnet with a lot of devices on it, we would refer to this as flat. So the issue here is that you have one layer 2 connectivity between all of the devices, and you have no control on who no control about who talks to who. You have different devices, different types of devices talking on the same network. So it also means that if these guys are, for example, Windows machines, they will send out a lot of multicasting and do a lot of these consumer stuff. And that would actually affect these machines from time to time. So the alternative would be to make a network that looks something like this. So I will have a network up here. I usually call this network something like user. So that's where you, that would be a network for all your user devices. We would probably have a network for our servers. And you have some sort of DMZ network for your internet facing things. Depending on the context, you might have that this would be your first layer into some other network with some more databases, for example. But the idea about this is that, let's pick a color here. You have some grouping here that has some network internet needs, they will need to be handled differently. User machines are inherently difficult because users want to do all kinds of things. And then when we have your server network, you can actually know what's going on the server network, so that you can put in proper firewall rules about what is allowed to go in and what is allowed to go out. And finally, the DMZ. The DMZ is for incoming from the internet. This would be, and this is a security category in its own. So when you have your other servers, then you don't want them to be accessible from the internet. So what we have here is that we have, in this example, we have 4 groupings, and you can set up security for the different ones. We have the user, we have the server, and we have the DMZ, and we have the, let's call them the DMZ database. So this is just an example. Depending on who you are, you want to do it differently. But it is to illustrate that you can have different layers in this, so that it's actually, this database here is actually very far from the internet. You need to go through that guy and so on. This will have some management interface. It might even be on the server network. Why is this relevant? Let's do a new page. So if we have our network with the single subnet and the server, and let's assume that you have a some sort of port forward going on here. This means that if this is, for example, your web server, this is fine, so that people on the internet can access your web server. Port 80, port forward from the router's IP, and so on, provided this guy is doing netting. So this guy will be exposed a lot, and this guy a lot less. But the issue is that when, if something bad happens to this guy, then suddenly you have that you have a compromised machine on the same network as the client machines. And then you will have a lot of interesting layer two options for the attacker. So you can do ARP spoofing, and you can do all kinds of other man-in-the-middle attacks, for example, and you can access services on the machine. And since this, for example, is a Windows machine, it might have access to Windows shells and such, or we might even add another server here. Let's do this, call this the file server, for example. So when you have compromised the web server, then you will have access to whatever stuff is in here in the same way. So this server here has the same access to the network as the client, so it will basically have access to the file server also. You might not have credentials and such, and that's why you need to attack this guy also. But a setup like this, so you will do, the attacker will do what we call lateral movement, which basically means that if he gets a foothold, he will start moving around on layer 2. Or, depending on your routing and firewalling, layer 3 a bit also. But the idea about lateral movement is that he will attack other servers on the same network. We have nice targets would be admin PCs. They also always have a lot of really nice passwords, and they use them a lot. So if you can sit on the admin PC for some reason, then you can get passwords, for example. Password, admin passwords. Or if you go for the file server, that would basically be a lot of information. Or the database, that would just be the same also. And if you are able to put yourself on the client machine, then let's just say exfiltrate using the client machine. So you gain a foothold by some problem in the web server, and you have easy access to everything else. And this is problematic in many ways. You also have the yes, we have a lot of best practice, that's fine, but on the internal side, everybody most people these days know that stuff shipped to the internet must be encrypted. It's much less on the inside of the network, because hey, it's not available. So it means that if you are able to do man-in-the-middle attacks, you're actually able to sniff traffic fairly easily, if you have stuff like FTP or Telnet or your LDAPs or your whatever protocol that you have that might be in plain text, SMTP that you have misconfigured, there will be a lot of options for unencrypted stuff in the internal network, so that he will be able to pick this up when he's on the same layer 2 domain. And you have very little options for blocking these when you have a design like this. And this is without him having physical access. He has just compromised the web server. If is your patch cycle is good enough? Do we has some sort of 0 day? Has he actually gotten some access because of some leaked passwords? It doesn't matter how he got on the web server, provided that he is able to somehow run scripts on it, which is a fairly common scenario. This would be the flat version. So if we go to the next guy, then we have the segmented version. So we try again with the we have the server network, and we have the client again up here, and we have the DM set. So we do again, we do some sort of port forward. This is your web server, and some sort of port forward. This is fine. So we will work with the web server. It will, let's add the servers from before. So we have this file server also. So we have the web server, and if this guy gets compromised, he will try to, if this guy gets compromised, then he will try to get access to the rest of the network. But he is in the DMZ network right now, and the design is that you know that the DMZ network is actually where you might be compromised the first. So, but in the scenario you have here, you actually have a lot of options over here in your firewall. So you have some sort of firewall rule that says internet to DMZ, okay, or at least a port forward or something similar. DMZ to, let's add some names here, user. DMZ to user, not okay. Oh, suddenly it became a lot more difficult for the compromised web server to actually access the client. Oh, so no lateral move to this admin PC or whatever he has in the user area. So it's suddenly more difficult for him to do this. Okay, this web server, it needs to have some sort of access to, let's call this guy the log server. Okay, actually he must be able to ship stuff to the log server. Fine. So then he will actually need to move to the log server somehow if he can. So the rules in your firewall. So you will need to be able to have some sort of DMZ to server. Okay. There will be some servers running that is accessible. Okay, fine. So he kind of needs to figure out which servers it is. He cannot, well, since all the ARP and the layer 2 traffic is separated away from him, he actually does not know which servers is available in the server LAN. And even better, you might log stuff in the firewall. So access on non-standard ports, block and log. Oh, this is ugly. So you are blocking all kinds of ports going from the DMZ to the server LAN. So this way, you will actually be able to have a place where you can see the traffic going between the different parts of the network, and you will have a place where you can add some firewall rules. You have a place where you can actually actively log stuff. And then you will also have the issue, assuming that he now, let's give it a one here. Let's assume that he owns this one also. He moves a bit, and then he now has access to one of the servers. Well, then he actually needs to move to the file server. That should not be that difficult, but since they are on the same subnet. And then he will need to go to the what's it called? And you'll need to open up for the client to have access to the file server. But will the file server have access to the client? Probably not. So you will have that some server to user. You're not allowing that. Why should you? But you will allow user to server because you need access to the file server. Okay, so this means no active move. This means waiting for opportunity. Waiting for opportunity. And this is interesting because then suddenly the attacker will need to sit and wait for you to access and make a mistake or follow a misconfiguration. But as you see, he has to go through a lot more steps. He has to, in order to get the, let's say, the admin interface, admin passwords, he will need to go through more problems. And some of the steps that he has to make, like scanning in order to find things, will actually be noisy in a way where he will be detected. You will notice that if you are not I'm talking about firewall rules here, right? How are we allowed to access things going from one segment to another? You might just have no firewall rules and then just route everything. This is close to being the same, close to being one subnet. With one major difference. And accept layer 2 access. If it means you cannot do an ARP scan and so on, so even if you do not implement these rules, you are actually better off like this. And also means that if stuff starts to break, if something starts to pump out a lot of information and so on, it will make sense. And also if you are it also means that the day you decide to implement security, which you ought to have done day one, but still, then it will be easier for you to implement stuff in the firewall to beef up the rule set in the firewall to ensure that you have a lot less problems. So, in summary, we have the flat network. And we have the segmented network. Flat segmented. There's not much discussion. Don't do this. Do this. And add proper firewall rules. This looks simple, but it gives you a lot of layer 2 traffic and will give you a lot of issues in the long run. So this is how we did it back in the old days, and we're not doing that anymore. This system here is easily implemented with switches and with VLANs and such. This is fairly trivial to implement now. So just do segmented. And group the, I can write that also, group by function. And sensitivity. It is a good idea. If you have a very large network, you could have designs where you have multiple routers, so you get further and further into the network. So if your database server is super important, then you will have it buried between you and a lot of other devices. So this might be your web server, right? So the further into the network you make, the more hops he has to do, and the more firewalling you have set up, the more difficult it would be to get to the database server where he can actually do a lot of damage. So segment your network and consider making it a deep network. Yes. Thank you.